Don't say nothing. Before we begin, can someone tell me if they've lost their ferret?
Time rolls out for the last time. You'll find me sailing on sad, but you know that in the end, our love was stronger when we began.
No forgiveness,
sins, and no regret. Just the times of our lives that we never forget. I'll be sailing on the ships of heaven when the tide goes out for the last time. You'll find me sailing on the ships of heaven. Wait for the end. I'll come sailing back.
Am I good? Kia toki ane te pai pai tapu, kei ngā waha kaka nui a tānei, kei ngā manu ti ori ori, parikā rangaranga, o rangamarai roa, o ngā hau e whā. E mihi atu te moana, Indian Ocean, a tēnā koe. E mihi atu. Te whenua, mangu pare, e paia, Shark Bay, tēnā koe. E mihi atu koutou mate, e re urupā. Raua, kona mate o mātou, mauri a mai ngā wairua o rātou. Ki konei e tangihia mihi a mātou katoa mō rātou. Nō reira, koutou kua nāro ki te pō. Haere ki tāwhiti nui, tāwhiti roa, tāwhiti pāmā māu. Nō reira ngā mate, haere, haere, haere atu rā. Ka huri au ki te kōrere ingari. I asked Gavin if I could offer an opening for our service today in a language that I was born with. And it pays definite respect to the things that give us life and sustenance. The Indian Ocean on my left, out to the west. The whenua that we stand on here at Shark Bay, and I pay my respects to the ancestors of past and the ancestors that are going to be our future. I see these young men standing earlier, holding hands, strong, as men and as a nation's future. I pay respect to them as we come today to acknowledge those who have passed, and in particular, James Thomas Poland, or Jimmy, as I know or have heard him known of. So this isn't working clearly, but is everybody able to hear me at present? Okay, that's a good thing. We'll work on the technical issue, because Michael's coming up very shortly to share with us a treasure. And I say a treasure simply because if I think about, one, the number of pages that some of you might have in your eulogy booklet, you'll see that there's a good swag of numbers there in the pages. But that, as I was reminded by Reverend Bill at the Shell Church, is because he deserves those pages. It's a testament to himself. And I suspect that if we had 800 pages, still there wouldn't be sufficient for all of us to understand what we're here for, to understand the man. And I read a little bit earlier, bit of a character in his younger day. I won't say hoodlum, but I'll say ragamuffin, because that's a fair word to use perhaps. And now that the technology is going, Michael, you're safe. So the good thing about all of that is that today we've come from far and wide, and I'm very, very pleased that we are not necessarily restricted in any way. If we are restricted, and this is not my platform at all, but I'm going to share with you, if we are restricted, it's because we're restricted in our minds. And I'll say no more. Open your minds and let the world be the way the world is. Love it for what it is. Black, white, yellow, pink, blue, or brindle. Nō reira, ka apiti hono tātai hono, rātou ki te hunga mate ki te mate. Ka apiti hono tātai hono, rātou ki te hunga ora. All those who are living. Kia ora. Kia ora mai tātou katoa. If you're looking at your order of service, you'll see that that was my particular task for today, which was to say welcome. And I've done that in part. I think to all of the Poland and Weir clans, or mobs as you might refer to them, I have to say a sincere thank you. I've been coming to Shark Bay on behalf of these families for a decade now, off and on. And the privilege belongs to me and my family to join with you and your own families here today to say farewell to Jimmy. My job is small, and the people, i.e. Jimmy's family, theirs is the major task for today, because you have to step away from here today with the courage that will take leaving Jimmy here, no longer at your grasp, no longer listening to the things that you talk to him about, until you come back. Today is a place where we say goodbye. Tomorrow, or on Christmas Day, or on Father's Day, or on Pop's Day, or on any other given birthday or anniversary day, you'll come here and you'll say, g'day, Pop. So we only say g'day or say goodbye once. We say g'day a million times, depending upon how often you come back. But you'll come back, because this is a sacred place where eventually we all come to pay our respects. So, without further ado, I don't know where Michael is. I can't see him in his beautiful hat. Just beside me. But Michael's going to share with us today what I might call a treasure. And I know that Jimmy's a fisherman, he was a boat captain, he was all those things. So treasure might sound like it's a word that might fit the particular theme for today, but it's not. For me, someone's life is a treasure. And that's our celebration today. And if we can share the treasure that we have held within these pages, and we can find all the gems that belong or that are resting there and take them away with us, then our battle is half won. Can I ask those people who need to have a seat to please have one? Don't let the bums go to waste out in the sun. Have a seat and you'll feel much more comfortable, because we could be here for a little moment. Okay, kind sir. You've got it on a big page?
Yeah.
Okay. I'll just set this up.
Can you hear me? Can you hear me? Firstly, to everyone that's travelled and come from far and wide, many, many thanks for coming and honouring Uncle Jim. So I've got the honour of reading out the eulogy, and thanks to the family for asking me to do it. Uncle Jim is a treasure and to remember it long. And sadly, the likes of that, Uncle Jim and other characters and people from Shark Bay, we won't see again for a long time. Let's hope it's not too far away. But So this is the eulogy of the late James Thomas Poland, Uncle Jimmy. James Thomas Poland was born on the 30th of November, 1927, in Shark Bay to parents William Coyote Poland and Nora Weir, Nee Bryan. He was the second eldest of the siblings. Johnny, JP, deceased, Margaret, Tom, deceased, and Tina. JP deceased, Margaret and Tom deceased all lived in Shark Bay, and they grew up together, sharing many milestones and lifelong memories together. Younger sister Tina lived away, but often came to Shark Bay, and on those occasions always made time to catch up with him. James had many nicknames throughout the years, outlaw from his teenage years, as he was known as the rebel in town during those years. As a teenager, he was a prankster, always tormenting everyone and playing tricks. To many people here today, he was known as either Paddy or Jimmy. He attended school in Shark Bay. In those days, most kids his age left school young to go straight into work. He left school in 1941 at the age of 14 to work as a deckhand on a local fishing boat for Mick Fry in Shark Bay. In November 1941, they were on a fishing trip. Then from afar, he could see smoke over towards Dirk Hardig Island. All the time, he thought it was a stockman burning off on the island, as they would often do. However, when they later returned to shore, he was told that it was actually the HMAS Sydney being blown up by the Cormorant. In 1947, his mate Laurie Bellotti, deceased, asked him if he was looking for a change and if he wanted to go to work with him out at Parent Station, mustering and shearing. Jimmy was keen and eager to learn something different. Laurie taught him everything he knew about shearing. Throughout their shearing days, they also worked on Dirk Hardig Island and on Forey Island. When on the two islands, they said it was like a holiday job, because on the weekends, they would take the boat out fishing, getting dugongs, turtles, and fish. As they grew older together, they had a saying between them. If someone asked Jimmy a yarn, he would say, "Just ask Porridge. He'll tell you." And then they would go ask Laurie, and his response would be, "Just ask Paddy. He will tell you." In the end, no one would get the yarn. Jimmy then returned to fishing and invited Laurie to join him. This is when he purchased his first fishing boat from Mick Fry, the Eloise, and started fishing for himself. Laurie also bought his own boat, and they started to fish together. He taught Laurie everything he knew about fishing in the bay. His second boat was called Little Dirk, which he fished from for many years. And then lastly, his final upgrade was a bigger boat called Cochise. Over the years, he had many deckhands work for him, including his two sons, Jimboy, deceased, and Gavin, and many years later, his grandson, Kim. Jimmy was a talented man on the waters. He had a natural instinct when it came to navigating the waters through the dark of night without lighting on the boat showing him the way. He would let the waters show him the way from the froth lines to the ripples, watching the tides and sand patches. Gavin recalls all the conversations throughout the years of his dad, Jimmy, telling him about landmarks and things to look out for. And it's only now that Gavin, who is still fishing today, can see what his dad taught him and how that instinct was instilled in him all those years ago. Late in the 1950s, Jimmy was out on a boat with six other blokes. It was on this boat that he first fed the dolphins at Monkey Mine. He named the dolphin Charlie, after Charlie Mitchell, who was on the boat, who later became his brother-in-law. He's actually my father. Little did they realise that this event would eventually change the way people interacted with dolphins. Jimmy then met a young lady, Teresa May Mitchell, deceased, known to us all as May. May already had a young daughter named Vivian, Tootie, as they called her. After some time, they decided to marry. Their wedding took place in Perth and was witnessed by friends Bill and Helen Grigo. In 1959, Jimmy and May welcomed their firstborn son, James Jimboy, deceased. And then lastly, in 1961, their baby son, Gavin, was born. Their first family home was on Brockman Street, a state house. When the house was first built, there were no other houses in the area. The builders had to carry all the timber up the hill. After a few years, Jimmy was given the opportunity to buy this house, which he gladly did. Happily living there with May and their sons, after many years of living together, Jimmy and May parted ways, and his sons remained in the house with him. His son Jimboy started his own family, who then filled the rooms of the house with grandchildren Kim, Vinka and Dolly, all living under the same roof. Jimmy was always surrounded by family and enjoyed life as a grandfather. After many years of living at the Brockman Street house and the countless memories made, it was time for Jimmy to sell the house and downsize to a much smaller residence. This is when he moved into a one-bedroom flat on Hartog Crescent. But before accepting this flat, he was first offered one of the pensioner flats near Silver Chain. Jimmy's response to that was, "No way. That place is full of pensioners and churches. There's no way I'm going there." And we could all hear him saying that. So he passed and then landed the Hartog Crescent flat. Gavin spoke fondly of memories of his father, Jimmy. Not only was he a father to him and Jimboy, he was their mentor, their teacher in life and on the waters. He was never the disciplinary. He always left that up to May. He was also a mentor and teacher for other young men in the bay, growing up, taking them on as deckies and teaching them about fishing. Next was the opening of his famous Hungry Gems food van, located near Tradewinds, as we all knew it back then. Jimmy cooked all sorts in this little van, but most would remember the fresh fish and chips and hamburgers. A few of the local girls worked with him as kitchen hands. Jimmy was so trusting of his customers, he would even let them book up and had a list of the people on his fridge. People would often say that his little Hungry Jim's van was the best in the West, and I certainly can attest to that too. In 2000, Jimmy started to have some knee trouble, which led him to retire from fishing. He travelled to Perth to stay with Raylene and Peter to have the operation on his knee, which kept him in Perth for 6 weeks. This led to the next chapter in Jimmy's life, his carvings. His dad taught him how to carve emu eggs when he was only a young boy. But at the time, he didn't have the patience for it. After his dad passed away, he found one of his dad's unfinished emu eggs. And while he was in hospital for his knee operation, he finished it by carving a koala on it. After mastering the art of carving emu eggs, he then began to work on carving pearl shells and baobab nuts and things out of wood. This then turned into creating jewellery, seahorses and snapper, fish from wooden pearl shells. It was endless to what he could create, and from any sort of material. He would run short of things to carve. He would get out the drawing book and sketch. He was a marvellous artist in more ways than one. He even made jewellery for celebrities, making a special piece made out of pearl shell for supermodel Elle McPherson and two small turtles for her sons. He never got to meet Elle, as a conflicting appointment with the post office lady meant he would miss out on personally delivering the jewellery. He named the piece for Elle the Elle Shell. Thanks to his niece Rowena Roberts, who organised Elle to come to Shark Bay, and Darren Capewell for showing her around, in turn giving Jimmy the opportunity to make them for Elle McPherson and her sons. Jimmy also had a talent for playing musical instruments, such as the mouth organ, the mandolin, and also the accordion, or the squeeze box, as some would remember it as. Out on the boat, fishing, he would often pull out his mouth organ, playing favourite songs and tunes. Jimmy was a prankster. Loved playing practical jokes on people, family, friends and anyone. I'm sure many of you here today will have a story or two about a prank Jimmy played on you or someone you knew. Maybe the dead snake prank rings a bell. Jimmy would find a dead water snake, tie a string around its neck, run the string across the road and wait for someone to pass by. As they would approach, he would wiggle the string, making it look as though the dead water snake was alive and scare the living daylights out of the people walking by. On another occasion, he gave a horse a fright while he was sleeping. Late one night, walking along Fitzgerald Street in Geraldton, Jimmy spotted this horse sleeping with his head over the fence. As Jimmy approached the horse, he gave the horse one big uppercut under his neck. The horse, in fright, fell back, landing on his backside. Jimmy was beside himself in laughter as he continued on his walk down the street. Just a couple of his pranks in which some of you may have encountered or heard about over the years. And there were many and all sorts. Jimmy was an immaculate cook. Many of his meals, chef quality. He could cook anything. Something which he more than likely learnt from his father, as he too was an excellent cook. His sons also inherited the same knack for cooking. Jimmy was even given the opportunity to go down to Perth and cook at the Perth Royal Show for the Shark Bay Fish Factory, promoting Shark Bay mullet. A trip he made for several years. Jimmy was also a member of Yajula and would always volunteer his time, cooking for their NAIDOC events, as well as the Shark Bay versus Kalbarri football and softball weekends. Both sons, Jimboy, deceased, and Gavin would also be right by his side. Jimmy was also the local barber in town, cutting hair. He must have been a really good barber, as his nephew Dennis Holt recalls the time when Kevin Capewell, Charlie Oxenham, and himself had just finished working in Carnarvon, and all of them were wanting haircuts. Now, at this time, there would have been several places in Carnarvon to get a decent trim. But for these three gentlemen, they all had their minds set on only one man cutting their hair, and that was Jimmy. So the three of them hired a plane. Now, Kevin wasn't too keen on flying and needed to be talked into it. Eventually, all three of them set off on the place, back to the bay, straight to their barber, Jimmy's chair, for fresh new haircuts. Jimmy also played cricket and was the team's wicketkeeper. He also was an excellent billiard player and often would travel to Perth and play billiards at the Savoy Hotel in the billiard room underneath the pub. Jimmy also became a car delivery man for Drennan O'Malley Motors, delivering cars from Perth to Geraldton. Jimmy's foot was a little heavy on the pedal at times, and as on a few occasions, Ron O'Malley would receive a few speeding fines, in the mail. Jimmy wouldn't realise it at the time, as Ron would never let him know about the fines, and would sort them out quick smart. Now this is what you call a mate. And these two mates shared 50 plus years of friendship. Jimmy loved to travel over the years, travelling to many locations with Peter and Raylene. He went to Bali twice, on a boat cruise to Vanuatu and their surrounding islands, interstate to Melbourne, Sydney, Gold Coast, and throughout WA to Broome, Derby, Marble Bar, Port Hedland, Newman, and also a few locations in southern WA. He would go anywhere. He enjoyed the wining and dining lifestyle, either at restaurants or at friends' places, often going over to Susan and Fabro's in Perth, enjoying Italian food, followed by a few good yarns. He also loved the casino and would frequent the casino almost every opportunity he could. Even though he wasn't much of a shopper, he was forever out and about shopping in Perth with Raylene. Peter would call him the battery, because whenever Raylene would head off to the shops, Jimmy would be sitting front seat. They would go for hours. Raylene would be trying all sorts of clothing and handbags on, and after many hours would often walk out empty-handed. When getting home, he would be the first to tell Pete, "Nothing today." Almost like a day lost. But it was good company for him. Jimmy was a celebrity himself with his very own exhibition, Pieces of Gutaragata, Shark Bay, Jimmy Poland, Jewelry and Objects, as well as starring in his very own documentary, Shark Bay Saltwater Stories, Yarning with Jimmy, Paddy Poland. The exhibition officially opened on 3rd of May 2013, followed by a second exhibition on 5th of September 2013. Then filming began for the documentary in 2013. The first red carpet premiere of the documentary was at the Shark Bay World Heritage and Discovery Centre in Shark Bay on 24th of July 2015. And that was a good event, because I actually drove up for it. This was about Jimmy telling stories of his early days, growing up in Shark Bay. It was also screened at the Perth Royal Show in October of 2015. On 22nd of January 2017, this documentary premiered on NITV and made the top three shows broadcast on NITV. In 2016, Jimmy suffered a heartbreaking loss with the passing of his eldest son, Jimboy, deceased. Jimmy had ongoing support from his son, Gavin, and grandchildren, who helped him through this time of sorrow. But this could never replace losing his eldest son. One thing we know is that he would have been happy to once again reunite with his son. Jimmy always made sure he was on top of his medical appointments and making himself available for checkups. He would drive or fly to Perth, staying with Raylene and Peter, and often staying longer than he needed as semi-holidays and catching up with Perth family. Doctors were always impressed with his health for a man of his age. In 2020, with Jimmy's health starting to fail, he had an appointment to go to at Silver Chain for a weekly checkup. This was a video link up to Carnarvon doctors. Dennis and Maureen went to pick him up, and Jimmy's first response was, "I'm not going." Dennis said, "Why?" He said, "They will send me to Geraldton, so I'm not going." Dennis wrote on his board and said, they are only checking on your medication and that he won't let them send him nowhere. Dennis got the nod and off they went to his appointment. Throughout the past few months, as his health continued to deteriorate, Maureen and Dennis nursed Jimmy at home, along with his son Gavin and Vicky, Tootie and Kevin, Julie Bowman and his grandchildren, who was able to travel back to Shark Bay to help support their pop, with his wish of being able to remain in Shark Bay. They reached out to many services such as Silver Chain, Shark Bay and Graham's in Geraldton to provide what was medically necessary to keep him happy and comfortable at home. A couple of nights before his passing, Jimmy wanted to go to the toilet. And at this time he asked Dennis where he was. Dennis said he was home in Shark Bay. Uncle Jimmy's response was, "Perfect." Sadly, late in the evening, on the 4th of June 2020, Jimmy passed away, peacefully at home with Dennis and Maureen by his side. Jimmy, you have left behind a legacy. You have left us all with countless memories that we will all continue to share and yarn about. You were a storyteller, always telling us about your past and things that you had encountered. One of your greatest treasures was your memory, and we're all richer for being able to hear the stories you told. And overall, you were a friend to many. Friend to the locals here in the bay, and to the tourists that did visit, and sought him out next time they came back. Especially those that would pick up your coffee tabs. Friends to people who you met on your travels, even those you met overseas. You never forget a face or the story behind where you had met them. You will never be forgotten. Rest easy now, Uncle Jim. Your spirit and soul are now sailing through the waves of heaven. Thank you very much.
Well, I don't know about you all, but that treasure on its own, just to have it rendered the way it was, thank you all very much. They say, well, not they say, I know for a fact that the book of Ecclesiastes tells us that there's a time and a purpose for everything that happens to us and everything that happens on this Mother Earth. And our time now is a time for us in our own silence to reflect on Jimmy and who he is for us. And I say is on purpose, because although these pages are full of written memory, each of you have your own relationship with Jimmy. And while we're listening to a beautifully chosen piece of music, in your own silence, just have a reflection on your relationship with him.
You're my honey bun sugar plum, humpy and yumpkin. You're my sweetie pie. You're my cuppy cake gumdrop, snickum spickum. You're the apple of my eye.
Got sent home from school one day with a shiner on my eye. Fighting was against the rules and it didn't matter why. When Dad got home, I told that story just like I'd rehearsed. then stood there on those trembling knees and waited for the worst. And he said, let me tell you a secret about a father's love, a secret that my daddy said was just between us. He said, daddies don't just love their children every now and then, it's a love without end, amen. It's a love without end, amen. When I became a father in the spring of 81, there was no doubt that stubborn boy was just like my father's son. And when I thought my patience had been tested to the end, I took my daddy's secret and I passed it on to him. I said, let me tell you a secret about a father's love, a secret that my daddy said was just between us. I said, daddies don't just love their children every now and then, it's a love without end, amen. It's a love without end, amen. Last night I dreamed I died and stood outside those pearly gates, when suddenly I realized there must be some mistake. If they know half the things I've done, they'll never let me in. But then somewhere from the other side I heard these words again. And they said, let me tell you a secret about a father's love, a secret that my daddy said was just between us. You see, daddies don't just love their children every now and then, it's a love without end, amen. It's a love without end, amen.
Just the closing words of that particular piece of music, a love without end, amen. And if each of us have that, then each of us have our own treasure. Before I ask the pallbearers to come back to their positions adjoining Jimmy's coffin, I'm going to share with you the fact that today, after we leave here, the cemetery, the Garden of Stone, we're all going to congregate again back at the old pub. And ordinarily, if we were there now, we'd be watching we'd be taking a gentle stroll, I should say, through Jimmy's photo album. And I suspect that there are many, many memories held within that album. But that's the invitation to you all, back to the old pub. And I'm sure that we're going to share a number of things there, most importantly memories and stories, our own stories of how we have had a relationship with Jimmy. James Thomas Poland. And please, before I even start here, if I get some of these pronunciations wrong of these children and grandchildren, forgive me, but I'm going to do my best. James Thomas Poland, the son of William Coyote Poland and Nora Weir, née Brian, the father of Jim Boy and Gavin, and the stepfather of Tootie. Father-in-law of Donna, Vicky, and Kevin. A brother to Johnny, to Margaret, to Tom, and to Tina. A grandfather to Vanessa, to Kim, Nivanka, Rakisha, Rodessa, Cody, Roslyn, Christine, and Kevin James. A great-grandfather to Keegan, Kaitisha, Kitana, Calum, Keanu, Keeley, Kobe, Sheldon, Ashton, Shania, Alia, Anthony, Simone, Jaden, Jeremy, Levi, Caitlin, and Blake. How many is that, just off the top of your head? Lots. And a great-great-grandfather to Kingsley, Leticia, Chloe, and Nate. But so too an uncle and a friend to many. And those of you that are here are just a portion of those that are far and wide, not just here in WA, but across Australia and around the world, who understand who Jimmy Poland is. And I mention all those names because along with the legacy of art, the legacy of storytelling, the legacy of fishing, all of the things that happen here in the bay, these names that I've just read and I referred to earlier are Jimmy's future. And it's important that we mention them on purpose. So if you hold on to one of these names and it's yours, given to you by birthright, congratulations. You've got ancestors, foundations of stone. Can I ask those men to come back to their places, please? There's a song written by a Scottish fella who married a Kiwi girl. And I note Jimmy's, perchance meeting of an Australian supermodel. But Rod Stewart, who's about to sing this song, actually got wed to a Kiwi supermodel. And most of you won't know this, but Rachel Hunt is my sister. I'm kidding. Ladies and gentlemen, these fine men are making their way to the gravesite and casting in their treasure. And it now behoves Jimmy's immediate family to lead all of you in the same procession as you come to this mound of Mother Earth and you cast your piece of her in with Jimmy, with your sentiments, your treasure, and your thoughts. Can I say to all of you who have come today, please make your way back to the old pub afterwards. But when you make your way to the roofs that house your families, the ones that you love and the ones who love you, please get there safely. And again, to Gavin and to Vivian and to all of Jimmy's family, immediate and or wider, a sincere thank you for letting me and my family join you all today. Thank you all very much.
When the time